morning. Hallelujah. Somebody clap your hands for Jesus. How many grateful this morning? I know I am grateful. My heart is just full of praise. Just thankful for what God is doing this past week. If you're online or in-house, I advise for you just share this message. If you're online or in-house, share this message. Let it be a blessing to you. Sorry about that. Okay, if you're online or in-house, just share this message. Take this time to evangelize at the Body of Christ in DFW. We just want to lift up Jesus this morning. Despite the distractions the enemy has been throwing with us this morning, we just want to give it all to Jesus this morning. Amen. But I want to read out of Psalms 102. Because this morning, like I said, I'm just thankful for what God's been doing. And it says, Psalms 102 says, "Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is that he hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name, for the Lord is good and his mercy is everlasting, and his grace endureth to all generations." Amen. And we're just going to believe that, and we're just going to lift up praises to him. And so if you just bow your head in a word of prayer. God, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you, God, just for what you're doing, God, in the midst of the body of Christ. God, we just come to you humbly, God, because we know that you are a healer, God. We know you're a provider, God, and everything that we need, God, is inside of your hands, Jesus. And God, we just exalt you, God, above how we feel, God, above circumstances, above situations that we may be facing this past week, Jesus. And God, we just honor you, God. We give you praise, God, not because of what you've done, God, because of who you are, Jesus. And God, we press in the spirit, God, even right now, God. And God, we rebuke Satan in the name of Jesus that tries to come against any technical problems, God, anything that tries to come in this place, God, and tries to distract, God, your people, God, of lifting you up, Jesus. And God, we lay everything at your feet this morning, God, whatever we might be facing, whatever we might be going through, God. And God, we exalt you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Somebody clap your hands for Jesus.
Oh, Victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to God.
Clap your hands for Jesus. How many of all the victory belongs to him this morning? Come on, we're going to praise him. If you can do me a favor, just clap like this. Write them on the tablet.
Write them on the tablet of your heart.
Oh, yeah. Write them on the
tablet.
The branches, he who abides in me will forever be fruitful indeed. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father except that he comes through me. So let not mercy
and truth
forsake you.
Let not mercy
and truth
forsake you. Write them on the tablet of your heart. of your heart.
Come on, all together, say.
Truth and the life, no one gets to the Father. And except that He comes through me,
hey, let not mercy,
let not mercy,
and truth,
and truth,
forsake you,
forsake you,
forsake you,
forsake you,
let not mercy,
let not mercy,
and truth,
and truth.
Forsake you,
forsake you,
forsake,
forsake.
Say we really ought to write them. How we gonna write the tablets on the heart?
Tablets, hey, of your heart.
You've been so good, you've been so merciful. Write them on the tablets.
Write them on the
I'm gonna
tablets
write.
Of your heart.
Hey, want somebody help me with this? Say trust in,
trust in the Lord. Woo. With
trust in the
trust
Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your might.
You got to trust.
Trust in the Lord with all your strength.
Say, lean not.
Lean not to your own understanding.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with hey. All your heart.
Trust in the
trust
Lord.
In
certainly not.
Lean not to your own understanding.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your
let
heart.
Let the Lord fight your battles.
Trust in the Lord with yeah. all yeah. your
let
might.
Let the Lord fight your battles.
Trust in the Lord with
give it to Jesus.
All your strength.
And lean not.
Lean not to your own understanding.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word,
Jesus. It's in my heart.
Heart.
It's in my heart. It's in my
I will
heart.
Hide your word in my heart.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I will hide your word in my heart.
Yeah. Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with
hey.
All your heart.
I know they talked about
trust
you.
In the Lord yeah. with all your strength.
They defend your name.
Trust in the with your strength,
I will trust.
Lean not to your own understanding.
So trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord.
We've been making do it for it now.
Trust in the Lord.
We've been making do it for it now.
Trust in the Lord.
But I come to tell you joy.
Trust in the Lord.
But I come to tell you joy.
Trust in the Lord.
It's coming in the morning.
Trust in the
hey,
Lord.
It's coming in the morning.
Trust in the
hey,
Lord.
Hang on in there.
Trust
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word in my heart.
I will.
I will hide your
will,
word
will,
in my heart.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word in my heart.
Yeah, everybody clap. Come on. Come on. There's joy in this room. There's peace in this room. If you call on the name, He will meet you where you're at. Hey, despite how I feel. Despite how I feel, your joy sustains me. Your peace sustains me. Hey, everybody clap those hands. Hey, it feels good in the room.
Ooh.
It feels good in the room.
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 Come on and let Him in.
It feels good in the room.
Come on and let Him in.
It feels good in the room.
It feels good in the room. Everybody clap those hands. Say, say,
I will hide your word.
Say, I will hide your word.
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 Lean on.
Lean on to your own understanding.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word in my
heart. I will hide your word.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word.
I will hide your word in my heart.
Hey, trust in the Lord. what I gotta do.
Trust in the
That's
Lord.
What I gotta do.
Trust in
I gotta
the
press,
Lord.
press my way.
Trust in the Lord.
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 I will hide.
Worship the Father. I mean, you're not going to wait to bow, but I choose to bow now because he's worthy of all the glory, all the honor, all the praise. Yes, the world will bow down and say you are God. Every man will bow down and say you are King. So let's start right now. Why would we wait? King of glory, fill this place. I just want to be with you. Just want to be. Just wanna be with you. I just wanna be with you.
Yes, the world
will bow down.
We'll bow down and say you are God.
Every man will bow down and say,
we'll bow down and say you are King.
So let's start right now.
So let's start.
Why would we wait?
We can praise you now.
In victory. Shout,
King of glory.
Come on, fill this place.
I just want to be with you.
Father, through my trials and my tests, Father, I will sing hallelujah until you come again. And I'll dance in your presence until you come again. I'm not going to wait, Father, I'll dance now. Yes, I'll sing hallelujah until you come again. And we'll dance in your presence until you come again. Somebody sing hallelujah.
Yes, we'll sing hallelujah.
Till you come again. And we'll dance in your presence.
Yes, we'll dance in your presence.
Till you come again. Somebody sing hallelujah.
Yes, we'll sing hallelujah.
King of glory. I just want to be with you. King of glory, fill this place. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you. He's King of my peace. King of glory, kill this place. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you. Come on and worship with me. King of glory, King of glory, King of glory, King of glory.
And I'll dance,
dance in your praise.
I'll dance,
dance in your praise.
I'll pray,
dance in your praise.
I'll surrender.
Dance in your praise.
I'll obey.
Dance in your praise.
Yes, I will.
Dance in your praise.
Yes, I will.
Dance in your praise.
Yes, I will.
Dance in your praise.
Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah.
I'll praise you.
Sing hallelujah.
I'll worship.
Sing hallelujah.
I'll bow.
Sing hallelujah.
I'll bow.
Sing hallelujah.
I'll obey.
Sing hallelujah.
I'll obey. Just want to be with you.
Hallelujah. How many of you can just see yourself just basking in his presence? I'm just grateful this morning. I just thank and I appreciate God for who he is and what he's doing. I thank God because I know who I am. And because of that, it is easy to serve the Almighty God. When you know who you are and you know whose you are, it's so easy to worship. It's so easy to be submitted. It's so easy to be obedient to God. And I'm grateful this morning. I was listening to the prayer before, the 15-minute prayer, and I just thought about how the enemy loves to bring so much noise in the midst of the storm. He loves to get your mind clouded, and he loves to get you thinking about this and what about this and what about that. And it's in that still small voice. It's when you just shut down all the noise and you say, God, what are you saying? God, what do you want to do? God, what is it that you're speaking in the midst of the noise, in the midst of your mind just going here and there? God is wanting to speak to his people. And I'm grateful this morning because I have learned how to listen to God in the midst of the noise. In the midst of the noise. And it ain't nothing but the enemy. It's nothing that he's doing. He just wants us to get so bombarded. He wants us to get so distracted by the things that are going on around us. But how many of you know that God said he wants us to cast all of our cares upon him because he cares for us? That's a God that I serve. That's the God that I want to worship and adore every day, all day. We thank God. This is our time to give God worship. We're going to worship God in our giving, as you can see behind me, ways to give on Cash App or Tithely. We thank God for everyone giving. We thank God for your donations and your love offerings and whatever God has laid upon your heart. We thank God because of you, we're able to keep the lights on and keep operating and doing what we're doing here, which is the assignment that God has given us. And we're grateful this morning. And if you would like to, you can give. And if, hey, whatever God puts on your heart, I keep saying this, we have no gimmicks. There's no gimmicks. So stand and give me 20, 30. It's whatever God is laying on your heart. This is your time for your worship with your God. Amen. I thank God for just the way that God is doing things. Let me tell y'all, the enemy has really been trying, especially in our AP system. We have so many churches around here, so people have been trying to come in and out of our AP system. So y'all pray for us, because I'm going to have to get someone over here to help me work with that. So I thank God for everyone. We have a few announcements. Sisterhood retreat this week. Oh, my goodness. I'm so ready for the sisterhood retreat. We have been on fire. I mean, it's like never before. God has been speaking. God has been showing up. Even the enemy's been trying. But God said he went before us. And I'm telling you, the other day we had 6 o'clock prayer. And I'm telling you, I just seen God just hovering over that place. I seen God waiting. I seen God just ready for every heart and every mind that's going to be there. And I know God's going to meet every sister. And even some of the brothers that are coming. I know that God's going to meet every need in that place, because that's what he does. He's a God that does not lack. He's a God that is concerned about his people. And where else would I rather be than where God is at? If God isn't there, I don't want to be there. What am I doing? I'm wasting my time. I want to be where God is at, because I know where God is at, there's deliverance, there's healing, there's peace. Amen. And I want to be in the place wherever God is at. And I just thank God for the sisterhood that we have here. Thank God for our sister Kelly. Congratulations. We're having a boy. Her and brother Demetrius, we thank God for them. We thank God. We missed you guys. We just thank God for everyone that is here. I thank God for just allowing us just to be a part of the body of Christ. Amen. And so mark your calendars also in June. June the 20th through the 23rd. You don't want to miss this. We're having revival here in Dallas, Texas with Apostle Jesse McCree. So you want to book, you want to mark your calendars for that. Y'all pray for us. We're looking at another building, and we're waiting for the people to get back with us. And so, yeah, it's next door. It's bigger, has 2 bathrooms, and everything that we're needing. So that's why we need your funds, so that God can meet our needs and so that we can, you know, do what God is calling us to do, because I know God is going to do great and marvelous things in the midst of the body of Christ. Amen. So that is all the announcements that we have right now. We are planning a fishing trip for the whole church. Megan, our little evangelist, will get back with everybody on that. Her and Minister Brooks, they're going to be planning that for us, a little outing, church outing for the whole body, not just the brothers, because there's some sisters in here that can fish. So we're going to be planning that really soon. So we thank God for that. If you would just bow your heads, if you're done giving your offering this morning, God, we thank you, Father, for just allowing us, God, to wake up this morning. God, there's nothing, God, that we can give, God, that compares, God, to the peace and the joy, Father. And so, God, we give the first fruits this morning, God. We give you everything, God, not just money, but our time, our body, God, and our mind, Father. We thank you, God, for just allowing us, God, just to even give, Father. And I pray, God, blessings, God, on those, God, that had a mind to give. God, bless, open up doors, God, move for them, God, financially, Father. God, we thank you, God, for just allowing us, God, with the funds that you have given, God, that we're good stewards, Father, over the money, God, that you have given us, Father. And God, that is going toward your ministry, Father. And God, I pray, God, blessings on everybody, Lord, that have given, and even those that had a mind to give. Father, be glorified in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand praise. Are y'all excited? I'm ready for the word this morning. We're going to be doing part two, me and Pastor Herb. We're going to be doing part two of the workman. I thought you was going to get that stuff. The workmanship of God this morning. So we're excited about that. How many enjoyed it last week? Amen.
Let's get another mic, maybe on this side. Do we have extra mic? And make sure everything is up. We want a little feedback. How many excited about? Hey, man, the Lord. Praise God. I am excited about what the Lord is doing. I feel like preaching a little bit. We don't know what the Holy Ghost is going to do. Amen. But we thank God for just being God and being so. Ain't he good to us? Hey, man, we serve a such a merciful and such a loving God. I tell you, I don't know why a person won't give his their life totally.
I forgot. We wanted Miriam to give.
Yeah, go. Yeah, can we just have church? Hey, man, Sis Kelly said we're going to roll. Let's have church. Hey, man. We want to open up with a recap. We want prophetess. I tell you, boy, there's some prophets in here, all in this room. Hey, man, God is so good. We want Miriam to open up with a recap. Somebody clap your hands for Jesus.
Hallelujah. Last Sunday, Pastor Herb and Pastor Tiffany did an awesome job of really bringing out man's state or condition before the fall, and just really bringing out the purpose of salvation. And I'm going to do a quick recap. Before the fall of Adam and Eve, they were fulfilled inwardly. God created them without sin. There was no regard to self. God created them complete and content in his purpose. After man sinned, then man started seeking fulfillment outside of God's purpose. He became selfish. When Satan's law, the law of sin and death, entered in man's body, it influenced man to search outwardly for completion, for meaning, or purpose. Romans 5 and 12, wherefore as by one man's sin enter into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for they all have sinned. For unto the law sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned, after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. Genesis 6 and 5 also says, and God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Satan placed man in his purpose, which had man on a path searching to satisfy self. The spirit of iniquity has reigned rampant in man's life, setting them on cycles of trying to find satisfaction or purpose in all the wrong places. God in the beginning created man without any wants because he was already complete in God's purpose. Satan's law has polluted and perverted God's creation. Man needed redemption. Man needed to be saved.
Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. She was saying, okay. Hey, man, you got to open it? Hey, okay, well, I tell you what, she ain't got nothing. Wow. Anyway, we're going to enjoy ourselves this morning. Ephesians, let's go to Ephesians. Let's go back to our foundational scripture, and we're going to try to open the floor, but I want us to really open our hearts this morning, because we're talking about the workmanship, which is the mystery of Christ, really. By raising of hands, how many ever been taught the mystery of Christ or the mystery of God? It's the same thing. Okay. Anyone else? Oh, well. No, y'all too. Anyone? Okay. So that's good, because if you haven't, because I didn't hear it. I wasn't taught it. I will say maybe 23 years of my salvation. And when you, this is why this is very, very vital, important to your salvation, because you can see the operation of God. It makes you really appreciate salvation. Amen. It makes you really appreciate salvation, because there are so many theories and doctrines out there that really sets you on a path of reaching, never coming into your full potential to work ministry. And this was the whole, I would say, the whole operation of Satan to do that. And this is why religion is so potent, and, you know, today. But the word of God, amen, when Jesus came, he came to set the captives free. He came, he was manifested that he would destroy the works of the devil.
And what is the works of the devil? What is the works of the devil? Sin.
Amen. Sin. I mean, y'all can agree with that. Sin, works of the devil. I mean, rather it be, if you go to, I believe that's in Galatians, you'll see, let's go there. That's fine. But let me just read this, and we're going to jump to Galatians chapter 5. And somebody can, if I got a reader there, you can read it. Just go to Galatians chapter 5 where it says the works of the flesh are manifested. So let's read the foundational scripture here. Go ahead. Ephesians 2 and 10, our foundational scripture.
I don't have my glasses.
Okay. Ephesians 2 and 10.
Ephesians 2 and 10. For we are his workmanship, okay, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them.
Now, God had created us in Christ, and this is what we want to explain. We want to explain that we already went over where we were before salvation. We went over that last week, and I think we're clear on that. There are so many things in the Bible, especially in Paul's writing, that describes us being before salvation. So we want to talk about today the baptism of Christ. We want to really just show the operation. How did we get in Christ? Right. Not in church. Right. You see, not in a denomination. Right. Not a part of an organization, but in Christ. Right. See, I want to free your mind from things that with your salvation, because we're not clear on God. We said then God ordained this to be. We were a mystery. We were a mystery in God that was hid before the world was even came into, amen, before the world was even made. So I want us to really see this. He says, for we are his workmanship, God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Now, some of those works, you know, it can be ministerial works. This is the works of Christ. It's not you. The excellency of the power of God is not you, but it's of God.
That's right.
Amen. It's God that both to will and to do of his good pleasure. It's God that worketh in us. And he's working in us by one spirit. We can agree with that. That's the word of God. Amen. Jesus said, you go back to the gospel, he said, Jesus would say things like this. He said, if I receive one in my name, you receive it me. Amen. So he was constantly trying to show us that how he was going to be manifested in flesh. If you go to back and you read and study John chapter 17, you'll see that. And then you look at John chapter, I believe that's chapter 15, quote unquote, where he began to say, believe it that thou, Philip, that I am in the Father and the Father in me, believe me for the very work's sake.
Yes.
You see? So he's want us to believe how God is in us by way of Christ. We got to believe that.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. Amen. Because it's not on our own merit or our own power,
yes,
but it's Christ that's working in us.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. And so we can rest in the fact and we can believe that he's with us and that we become a part of him. We are his workmanship, created in Christ to do good works. Love is a good work. So you didn't have love before Christ.
That's right.
These are the good works. Patience is the good works.
Yes.
As we talked about ministry, that's a part of good works. And see, many times if we have to really examine our hearts and see if we be in the faith, see if Christ is really working in us. If there's no zeal to do the will of God after salvation, then before salvation, you can try as hard as you want to.
That's right.
Amen. Amen, because there's no power in you. There's no power in you. That's why the Holy Ghost, which is the personage of Christ, this is Christ. That's why it's so imperative to have it. Yeah. I know I can feel it right now. She ready to go. I can, come on now.
Well, because you stated the will of the Father.
Amen.
And I think so many times we don't understand that there's a will. We have a will,
mm-hmm,
and if we don't want to give God that will, then his will won't be done in us.
So many times we think that we're separate. Our will is separate from God. Mm. But it's not. It shouldn't be as sons of God. Your will is to do the Father's will.
Yes.
You know, didn't Jesus say that? He said, it's not my will. So we know Christ had a will.
Mm-hmm. It's good.
We have a will.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, Christ said, it's not my will, Father, not my will be done, but let thine will be done. And how many of us are saying that? How many of us are allowing God's will to be done? And how do you know what God's will is if you're not reading his word? You cannot do the will of the Father if you don't know what is commanded of you. Right? And so Jesus understood what the will of the Father was because he was in tune with what God was saying. And so many times we believe that we are in tune with God, but we're not because we're not doing his will. So we wonder why we keep falling. We wonder why things aren't going our way. Well, because you're doing your will. Our will and God's will is not the same. It's one will. One will, not your will and God's will, and you're trying to intertwine your will with God's will. It's his will. It's one.
Right.
And so I think that that's one thing that we have to understand. Jesus told his disciples what? He said, deny your, if you want to come with live with me, deny your will, self.
Mm-hmm.
Will is self. You have to deny you in order to come and even follow Christ. If your will is in the way, you're not going to follow Christ.
Amen. And this is I'm glad you said that because that's the part of knowing what are the good works, amen, that he created us in Christ to be. And so many times as you were stating, this is why you have to have the Spirit of Christ in order to perform those works, amen, because you can't do it on your own will. This is part of us having the mind of Christ, God putting us in Christ to give us that mind to do what's required of the Father, what's on God's heart. And so, again, it's important for us to understand that because if you can have the Spirit of God and you can still usurp authority over it.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. But but it's imperative that you do have it because the way God sees us without it, you're just darkness. You're dead. You're dead. And what happens to a lot of times, I'm glad you're on that note, you just pinning that, because what happens to us a lot of times you just do that is you just be a part of dead works. You know what dead works are? Dead works are trying to work the works of Christ or doing what God say without the Spirit.
It's
dead works. So a lot of people do things, but it's a dead work. You can't give life. See, God has put everything that we need in Christ.
Everything.
He is the head of the body.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. He is God has given him preeminence over all creation.
That's it.
So again, that's why we have to really evaluate our hearts. Because this is the whole thing is for the devil to put an imagination in our minds and make us feel like we doing what's pleasing and we're not. That's an illusion. Amen. So let's examine ourselves and let's go ahead and move on, and I want to go to okay, all right. I want to go to Colossians chapter 2, and we want to start at verse 13. Colossians 2 and 13. And let's really watch this. And we want to go up. We want to start from 13. We want to go up to, and I'm going to be stopping in between here, but I want us to just kind of focus on, amen, this operation. How did we get into Christ? And this is literal, and a lot of times people don't see it because there's a veil, amen, over people's heart. And so this is what we're talking about. We're talking about today really the mystery of God, mystery of Christ. Okay, amen.
And you being dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh.
Now he says, and you being dead in your sin and sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh. Now he's relating the uncircumcision of the flesh. What he's saying is, this is what the uncircumcision of the flesh looked like: darkness. Because the flesh, see, God dealt with the flesh or the body. I want us to understand that, because I don't want us to get in a trap of hearing things where people always talking about your body. Amen. Because that can be a very stronghold on your salvation. So what he says is, he says, and you being dead in your sins and uncircumcised of your flesh. Now, can someone just give me another little feedback? What's another chapter that describes the uncircumcised of the flesh? Any other chapter, any other verse you guys may know? Those has been listening. Y'all been listening. Pastor Mike. Go ahead. Y'all got it? This is another scripture. This is open. Okay. We'll give you time. Yeah. What's another scripture that describes uncircumcision of your flesh? Romans, he got it. That brother got a mic. You get it? Psalms 51:10. Can somebody get that and read it? Verse 2. Psalms 51. Somebody can read it for him. Okay. Go ahead.
That's good.
Public school, but all right.
Right.
Creating me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. That's cast me not away from your premises, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me.
Mm-hmm.
Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation.
That's good.
And uphold me with a willing spirit.
Yes, that's good. That's good. I love that when you that Psalms 51, because in Psalms 51, we see when David said, and from my mother's womb, I was shaped in iniquity. And man, even David had to be born again.
That's right.
Amen. Even all the patriarchs that we read about of faith, of belief, they had to be born again. And that's a real good one, because they wasn't circumcised by the circumcision of Christ, or they wasn't, amen, born again. Amen. So again, that was good. So it says, he says, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh hath he quickened together with him. Quickened together with him, having forgiven all your trespasses. Okay, come on, let's go up. Now notice quickened with him. That's a really good detail to really understand too, because one scripture in Colossians chapter 3, he said, if you've been risen with him,
mm-hmm.
risen, that's a positional change.
Yes.
I want us to see that we're not in the flesh no more. You're not in the flesh. You're in the spirit. Romans 8:9, it says you are in the spirit. And so we need to see this. See, so the language, when we're reading Paul's writing, you got to see you're sitting in a heavenly place. Amen. So all the things that with the Spirit of God in you, you're sitting in the heavenly place. And so again, this is how we, amen, this is how we fight. Amen. This is you understanding, knowing that you're with God. And salvation was, I'm telling you something, salvation was a miracle. How God can literally take you out of the flesh, amen, and put your soul in the Spirit of God, put your soul in the Spirit back in your body. He did it in a millisecond. This was a miracle.
Can I say this?
Go ahead.
And I know we talked about this kind of last week, right, about when we say we're in the flesh. We know that we're in this body. So when the Bible is talking about being in the flesh, it's talking about operating according to the desires and impulses.
I'm glad you said that. Come on.
Of the physical That's body good. Being separated
mm-hmm.
from the influence of the Spirit of God.
Okay.
It refers to a living in a way that is controlled by sinful nature and the law of sin and death. Romans 7 and 5.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever you hear in the flesh, that's what it's referring to. Living in sin. Living apart from God. Because as Pastor stated, when the Bible talks about how you're not in the flesh. What do you mean we're not in the flesh? But now you're in the spirit. Those that are his. Those that are the sons of God. We now live in the spirit of Christ. So we're not walking according to how we used to walk anymore. Now we're walking in the spirit. He said, if you live in the spirit,
yes.
Now walk in the spirit. There's always two connotations I think about Jesus. God is always showing us two sides. People that are walking in the flesh, meaning walking in the sinful nature, and those that are living, listen to that, living in the spirit, meaning Christ. Now we're in Christ. As we stated here, I want us to look at this example before we keep going. When we were in the flesh, okay, this is us. When we were in the flesh, this is what happened to us, right? Sin took dominion over us.
Yes.
Can you see my soul in there? Y'all seen the rock before? Can you see the rock? You can't see the rock because now your soul, the you, the personage mm-hmm. of you,
it's
the person, the will is held captive in this darkness.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't it say, and sometimes when we were in darkness, held captive, we did the desires of this. What this is your body, your temple. What is touching it? This sin.
That's it.
This sin is touching this vessel. It is. You're doing the lust of what's in you now, what's holding you captive. This is what it's saying, the lust of the flesh.
Right.
That sin that is in you, it is driving you to do whatever it wants you to do,
mm-hmm.
right? So I want us to understand the difference. This, before salvation, before you came and you gave your life to God and God filled you with his spirit, this is how we looked. Our soul was held captive. Amen.
Let's look at Galatians. Go to Galatians 5 and 19. Let's look at some of the works. We talked about that in the beginning, the works of the flesh. Amen. Before salvation. Let's read some of those. Galatians 5 and 19.
Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: mm-hmm. adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murder, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time mm-hmm. past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
Wow. Well, isn't that plain? And see, that's why the flesh, that scripture that we all, most times, a lot of theologians get that twisted up. We hear it all the time. The flesh lusted against the spirit. Look at the context of that. Amen. This is what he's talking about. Those that are under the law, are the works of the flesh, are these. So when you have people like this in the church, this is what he's saying. You got those that's under the law, that's manifesting the works of the flesh. They lusted against those that are walking in the spirit. They are contrary one toward another. So Paul went on said, so you cannot do the things that you would.
Yeah.
Amen. So no, when you can't, and I say this all the time, you cannot mix. And as Jesus said, you can't put new wine in old bottles.
Can't do it.
Don't mix. See, it's by grace. You would say, not of works. The law couldn't free you. I don't care how much you do. The law was a schoolmaster pointing you to Christ. This was the whole problem, amen, what Paul was dealing with. Again, when man come in and setting rules, legalism, certain things you have, those. I've experienced when we set laws in church, Or when a man starts setting another standard, don't you realize you go right back in the flesh? That's you're prone to what? Fornication. All these things is what starts to, you start seeing the works of it. Mm. Because now you're going back up under law. And you fall from grace. Amen.
Even if you look at that Galatians 5, he says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith mm-hmm. Christ has made mm-hmm. us free.
That's right.
And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. So it says, behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I have testified again to every man that is circumcised, that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Christ is become of no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. And that's what she just said. Many of times in this chapter, that's what it's talking about. It was talking about how those Judaizers was trying, you were free, and now you're trying to come back and say, no, we got to do this, we got to do that. And Jesus said, Paul said, you're free. God has made you free. Why would you want to go back up under that when Christ has came to give you liberty to do what he has set the captive free of doing? Now it's in us. It's written in us. It's in our hearts. That law is written now in our hearts. You don't have to tell me to do it. I automatically do it because it's now it's my nature. And that's what we want you to understand. It's your nature now because of the workmanship that Christ did, that God did. It's a workmanship. It's something that God did. Nothing that we could do, nothing that the law could do, because if it did, he said you would have been able to do it. They could not satisfy God. They could not do it in the Old Testament. They couldn't, all the laws that God gave them, they couldn't even satisfy it. Why? Because he was not living in them. But now Christ lives in us. Now we're able to walk it easily because of his grace, because of his mercy that's in us now. Amen.
Praise God. Okay, let's that's so good. I mean, anybody got a little increase, add, man, hey. Praise the Lord. I'll tell you what. Let's go back up, because I don't want to be done went somewhere. Let's go back up. Let's keep reading. Verse 12. Back to, we're going to jump back to Colossians 2 and 12. Colossians 2 and 12.
Buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead.
Okay, and then he's now. Okay, I want us to see this. He says, "Buried with him." Let's go to another scripture in Romans chapter 1. Can we get that? Romans chapter 1. Let's read that.
Verse 1.
And we're just gonna let these scriptures. I mean, really, it's self-explanatory. If you just let the Bible interpret scriptures. God don't need any help. So, I mean, it's plain. But the problem is with many people today, they don't reckon themselves dead. They don't understand it. Wow. You know, amen. They don't consider themselves dead because of unbelief. Yeah. Amen. Because of what we see, you know, if you don't believe in what the scripture's saying, you can't have life. How can you can hear this Sunday after Sunday, you can know, you know, the word, but if you don't believe it, you'll never have life. Amen. You can't perform it. You won't perform the works of God. And this is why many times people don't have the confidence. This is why many times people vacillate. They are up and down. They walk, it's so up and down, it's not consistent. See, God wants us to be consistent when I walk. And this is why I encourage us, even those that are hearing us online, understand the word, stay in the word. Understand the power that's in your life. Amen. Don't take that grace and as Paul said, I don't frustrate the grace of God. Amen. He made sure that he stayed obedient to the will of God. And God wants obedience. We talked about that last week. He wants our obedience. You cannot experience, amen, the power, or you cannot perform the good works of Christ without obeying what God has commanded us to obey.
Can I say amen. This? I think it's very important. And as you state this, we all have to come to grips with that. That the word has the authority. If you don't believe that, as he stated, I can tell you all day long, but if you don't believe it, then it will be a struggle for you. It will be something that you feel like is unattainable because you don't see it the way that I'm seeing it, or you don't see it through God's perspective. And that's one thing that I have learned a lot, is that I don't need to see through your eyes. Show me what God is saying.
Lord Jesus.
And if me and you don't agree with what God is saying, then his word is authority. Then the discrepancy is someone don't believe. I believe in what God is stating. If God said Jesus came to destroy, listen to the word destroy. You cannot bring something back if I destroy it. If I broke this glass, I can put the pieces back together. But he said Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. You have to believe that. Amen. You have to believe that God said you are complete in him. You have to believe. What does complete mean to me, God? It means that God said that he's the one doing the work. Complete means that there's no lack. There's nothing that you're missing. You're not missing anything when you are a son of God. So then what am I missing then? I was going to say Aunt Tiffany. My baby's talking about me. Tiffany, what do you think? What are you saying? I forgot my thought.
Say, what am I missing? You said.
Thank you, Lord. There it is. Knowledge.
That's right.
Amen. You're That's missing good. The That's knowledge.
Good. That's good.
This is what hinders. This is what hinders this. It hindered me in my walk. It hindered me.
Amen.
It hindered me in my walk. In the beginning of my salvation, it hindered me because I didn't understand who Christ was. I couldn't see Christ because it was not being ministered to me. That knowledge of who Christ was not being ministered to me. I was being preached another man's doctrine. And because of that, I saw through his failures. I saw through his eyes. And I could not see Christ. Uh-huh. So now here it is, knowing the revelation of Christ. Kenya, I read this word and I see Christ through the whole scriptures. It's all about him. We would not be here today if it wasn't for his sacrifice. So the word of God is testifying of Christ. Who he was, what he was coming to do, all of that. Everything in the Bible is talking about Christ. I couldn't see that. And you know why? Because of what was being ministered to me. If you cannot see Christ in this word, you will not live like Christ lived.
That's right. And what happens, as you stated, there does remain a veil, amen, over your heart. And this was the whole problem with Israel. You know, when he came on the scene, they couldn't discern the last Adam.
And they had his word.
Man.
They grew up reading about him, but could not see him right in front of them. What does that tell you? You can have all the knowledge that you think, knowledge, head knowledge. But if you don't have the Spirit of God, he's the one that reveals the word. He's the one that peeled back that veil.
That's good.
He's peeling back the veil. Not what some say, not what, you know, I listened to somebody that they was telling me something. I was like, where you get that from? Oh, Google. You're going to Google and telling me what the word said? You know what I'm saying? Like, AI is telling you? Let the Spirit of God, the Spirit of God tell you. But see, that's where people go nowadays. Because if you don't have the Spirit.
2 Peter chapter 1.
If you don't have the Spirit, you're not going to be able to see this revelation.
Man.
Go ahead, sir.
Go ahead. And get Brooks, you get 2 Peter chapter 1. Go ahead.
Hey man, we enjoying ourselves.
I just wanted to point out something that you said, Dad, because a lot of people don't understand when people say that you are dead. A lot of people go to what they can see in their mind and like, yes. How are you saying that that I'm dead when I'm walking and I'm talking? A lot of people don't understand the word when the scriptures are saying that ye are dead. He is talking about dead to sin,
yes,
and alive unto God. So even in Romans 6:11, it says, likewise, reckon yourself to be dead indeed unto sin.
Yes.
It is sin that had brought death in. So we have to understand that prior to salvation, this is what death looked like. Mm-hmm. We had no life in us. The only thing that brought forth life was Christ. So the scripture says, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And another scripture says, hold on, let me go to it. It says, ye are dead and your life is hid in Christ. When the scripture says you're dead, he's talking about sin.
Yes.
To the works of the flesh. You have died to that thing. Yeah, and you are now crucified. Are alive unto God to fulfill his will and to fulfill his purpose. So I just wanted to bring that out.
Amen. Let's jump to Romans chapter 1. We're going to start reading that and we're going to show. I said Peter, but then Sarah went on. She went over there. So now we're gonna go ahead and jump because I want to just stay with the flow of everything. I'm trying to. Okay, Romans chapter 6, verse 1. Come on.
What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound?
Now see, notice Paul, because a lot of times, you know, people, and I know we know this, but people online, some people don't understand. Grace brought salvation. Grace brings deliverance. Amen. Grace is power. Grace is not a ticket to sin. It's not. If grace is ministered, and there's it creates a want in you. That's not the gospel. That's not the grace that the Bible is talking about. Grace came to reveal holiness.
Yes.
To show us a life that we can live right now in this present world. Amen. So he says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. Come on.
How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein?
Dead to sin.
And I just want to say this.
Please do.
People do not understand grace. Grace was in eternity before sin started in time.
Come on.
Sin only started in time. Grace was in eternity. That was the Godhead. They had already planned. Grace is so much stronger than sin. Mm. So what Paul is saying, how is something that has eternal power called grace?
Come on.
Allowing sin that only started when Adam and Eve decided to take that path, have more power than grace?
Yes.
Grace is so strong and powerful. It's a keeper.
Yes.
It's a sustainer.
Yes.
It will keep you from falling. Grace is the workmanship of God.
Yes.
Grace is the Holy Ghost coming down from eternity into time to talk to you, to walk with you, to be your guide. And what Paul is saying, and I can just feel these scriptures coming to life. How shall we?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
How shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid, because grace is what killed sin.
Yeah, come on now. Come on.
Grace is what killed it on the cross.
Yeah.
Yes.
When Jesus got on the cross, he killed sin.
Yes. Man.
That's why the veil was broken.
Yes.
Because it was now manifested in Peter, like he said. What was in eternity was manifested in time. Mm-hmm. So you got to see the eternal plan of God.
Mm-hmm. Man. Man, it just makes me think about the scripture in Ephesians 1. Paul there in Ephesians 1, he really spells it all out, being in Christ. He talks about how God has accepted us in the beloved. Amen. And so we're going to talk about that, how we got in the beloved.
Yes.
and the beloved got in us, and we got in him. Amen. Look what it said. Okay, verse 3. Somebody read that, verse 3.
Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death?
We were into his death. Into his death. When he died, amen, we were crucified with him. Amen. Many of us, I like, right after he says, live any longer than, so Paul asked the question, what do y'all understand what God truly did?
Yes.
He's asking, do you get it? Are you comprehending what salvation was? Do you understand, amen, what grace is?
Yeah. Yeah.
Know ye not that so many of us,
yes,
as were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death? Ask you a question. Mm-hmm. See, that's why, brother, I love God.
Yeah.
Amen. I may not have the best articulation. I may not have all the scriptures, but I love Jesus. Yes. Because he done something for us. It was a miracle. Amen. We are truly free.
Yes.
And so he's showing us something here. He said, baptized into this death. Okay, look at verse 4.
Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death.
Okay.
That like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father.
Okay. Now he's showing the operation. He's showing the operation. Just like Christ was raised from the dead, the sins of the world was in him. See, that's why he God made him to be like his brethren. He can identify with us because he has sin. He knew sin too. Because God put all the sins of the world on him. He was the first begotten from the dead. When he rose, we rose.
Even so, we also should walk in newness of life.
Yes, come on.
For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection.
And there you go. Now, he ain't talking about the resurrection to come. He's talking about salvation.
Come on.
I'm talking about salvation. See, Jesus is a baptism. Let me tell you something about him. Jesus Christ is a baptism. He a circumcision. And he all that in a bag of chips. Amen. So discern him. Go ahead.
Let me say this about grace. If you look at 1 Peter, and this all correlates with Romans 6, mm-hmm. 1 Peter 1 and 18, look at this. It says, for as much as ye know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things,
mm-hmm.
as mm-hmm. silver and gold, from your vain conversations received by traditions from your fathers.
Mm-hmm.
He said, but with the precious blood of Christ, look at grace, that's grace, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world,
mm-hmm.
but was manifest in these last times for you, who by him do believe in God, that raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might be in God. When I was looking at that, I seen how Christ's blood in the plan of God was already set,
yeah,
before the foundation of the world, before even Satan was made.
Yeah.
That's right.
Before sin entered mm-hmm. the world or anything like that. The Godhead had already made a plan to have children, to have a kingdom.
Mm.
So we have to understand who we're dealing with.
Yes.
That's
good.
We have to understand who we're dealing with. We're dealing with a God,
yes,
that sits in the Most High.
Yes. Lofty place. Come on.
In the high and lofty place.
Yes.
We have to understand that God knows the end of a thing before even touching the beginning.
Yeah.
What? I be thinking about that. I said, how you know the end before the beginning? How you know that?
Isaiah 46
and
10.
He's so good, but he's so intentional.
Yes, he
is. In his manifold wisdom, that he's killing everything with love.
Come on. Mm-hmm.
He's killing everything with one man, Jesus.
Yes,
yes, he is.
With one love. And that love came to talk to us.
Yes.
Came to love on us,
yes,
came to tell us of his plan,
yes,
came to talk to us about what he had in eternity. Yes. If we really just tap into that thing, we will start to see that all these vain things mean nothing. I was talking to my husband this morning. I said, even when we speak in tongues, that heavenly language, I said, I'm bilingual. I just started to think. I said, I am bilingual. When the angels, when I begin to speak in tongues, the angels just start to stare. She's speaking a heavenly language.
Heavenly language.
You're talking about a language on earth. I'm speaking in the heavenly conversation. Me and the Holy Ghost just going at it. Y'all got to tap into this. Right. I'm not in. I'm not. I'm a pilgrim.
Yes, Lord.
Passing through.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
You got to believe that. And that's where the enemy tries to come in and steal that belief that this is what God did. This is what he intended through Christ Jesus. But if you don't believe that, if you don't grab a hold of that, we'll always be thinking that this is what we are, walking around. But we got Jesus. This is us, and this is Christ. Christ, he just on side of us. Me and Christ is walking. Me and Christ is walking. But let me tell y'all, when you get baptized, what he said, into Christ, this is what Christ do to you. This is what Christ do. He sanctifies you. He purifies you. Hallelujah. Now you're in Christ. You're not outside of Christ. Christ ain't walking around and you just follow him. You've been baptized into Christ.
Come on.
Into Christ. Not into you.
Holy.
Not into what you... But in, what did it say? What did it say?
Sanctify. He said, 1 Thessalonians. Somebody get that word. Get that scripture. Because, I mean, people listening, y'all may know, you know, some of y'all know this, but let the scriptures talk. Let the, hold on. Slow it down. Hold that. Because we're going to put some scriptures with this right here.
Yes.
1 Thessalonians 5 and 23.
Thank you, Lord.
Come on.
Thank you, Lord.
And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And
some
I
of
pray,
it. Now you still trying to get you still sanctifying your feet.
Holy.
That's part of your one of your. You know what I'm saying? This halfway right here. And you know how we do. I'm wrestling with my flesh. You know these things. Come on.
And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless.
Body, soul, and
conscious.
Spirit.
Hold on. Look at holy. Look at the definition of holy.
Come on.
It means complete to the end.
Yes.
Perfect. Absolutely whole. So you're telling me when the Holy Ghost, grace, look at the power of grace. The power of the scripture says the whole Godhead is in you.
Yes.
Right.
So what are we doing saying that we're wrestling with sin? Wrestling with the devil. When the Holy Ghost comes inside of you, everything about
you
is holy and sanctified unto God.
Yes.
Everything about you is complete. You don't have to work for this thing. You don't have to pray 10 times a day. You don't have to fast 10 times a week. You just be led by the Spirit.
Yes. Yielded.
You just be yielded to the Spirit that's already inside of you.
Yes.
That's what grace does. Grace says,
the influence.
Rest.
Come on.
Grace says, rest. I got this. Let me finish this work.
Yes.
Let me pass these tests that's coming your way. Let me do it all.
Because
but so many times. But that's what grace does. Grace says, I'm the one that's fighting the battle.
Yes.
Because I already seen it.
Yes.
Grace says, I came down here and stepped in your body. You didn't have to. I put you in a heavenly
place. Yes.
Come on. Jesus.
Yes.
Grace.
Yes. Grace.
What grace has done. Grace stepped into our souls, Jesus, and wrapped us into himself.
Yes, Lord.
Grace wrapped us up into love and said, let me fight your battles.
Yes.
But so many times we get restless on the course.
Yes.
But so many times we get restless. We get hopeless because we can't see the finished work.
Yes. Yes.
But this is what requires faith. Yes. This is what requires hope.
Yes.
Yes. He said, let me fight your battles.
Yes, Lord.
When the weight of the world gets heavy, let me finish the course.
Ooh,
when circumstances and situation pushes you, Just fall on your knees and let me pray in the spirit for you. Because I know what you need.
Yes.
Because the spirit knows what you need. You don't know. The spirit knows.
Yes, it does.
The spirit of love, the spirit of grace, the spirit of power of love in Christ Jesus has made you free from the law of sin and death.
Yes, Lord.
But allow this life to be in you. Allow it to rest upon you. And we have to understand this, because on this road, all we have to do is yield. That's all he's saying. Just abide, because the works was already finished.
That's right.
On the seventh day, God rested from all of his works.
Amen.
From all of his works, God. And in Hebrews, he said, I pray that ye enter into his rest.
Yes, yes, Lord.
You have to enter into his rest. What is he saying? Everything in your life was finished on the seventh day with God.
Yes.
Everything in your life was finished. This thing was already done. So many times we get anxious and we allow these things to get us moving presumptuously. But on the seventh day, God rested from every little thing.
Come on. Hallelujah.
Every single thing, God rested and he said, it is good. And he said, now just wait for the kingdom.
The manifestation. Come on.
Yes. Glory to God. Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Glory to your name.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise God. Amen. And truly, our trust got to be, amen, in his word and what he said. Because let me tell you something right now. You ain't going to make it if you don't believe in his word. Amen. If you're not getting into his word and you're not loving, amen, God's word, you can try to be a good person for a little while. But if the word of God is not attracted to you, amen, you don't find it a delight in his word, you won't make it. Amen. Jesus fought the devil with the word of God. Amen. It is written. It is written. Amen. It is written. We can't come from, you can't put your dupes up and fight them with some imagination, some passed down, watered down. Amen. And it's not the word of God. It got to be line up on line, precept on precept, here a little, there a little. It has to be the word of God. And as the Lord was speaking, I could just, you know, hear even what Sarah was saying. That's grace is power. Grace is power. The scriptures say we can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. Amen. We got to trust in him. And so, again, when we're going through our trials, when we're going through circumstances, when we're being perplexed in our minds, we got to learn to trust in him. We have a treasure in these earthly vessels.
Yes.
Paul said, being cast down, but yet not destroyed. Yes. Being perplexed, being in this, he said, I still got hope. Amen. Still being going through things in life, we still have a great expectation, but it's incumbent upon us to trust in God. You say, preacher, say, how you trust in God? How do I trust in God? When God is dealing with you and telling you to go pray, that's proving trust. Amen. When God tells you to do something, he tells you to go forgive, you go forgive. That's proving your trust.
Yeah.
Amen. When God's telling you not to look at certain things, not to be around certain different things that may compete against the influence that's in you, you obey God. That's you know what you're telling God there? God, I trust you. God, I love you. It don't matter. Let me encourage you right quick. Let me encourage you real quick. Ain't nothing in this world. I love my wife, love my children, but I don't love them more than God. Men and women, don't get it twisted. Let me give you a nugget too, even in a marriage. We're talking about this, talking about grace, baptized, because when you baptize, when you get the power, I'm trying to show you how to use it. Even in a marriage, you got to love God more than your spouse.
That's it.
Don't put your trust, amen, in your spouse. You love them, but do not put your trust. I love my wife, love my children, but love, you got to pray. Mm-hmm. Women, and I'm going to say this too, women are looking for leaders. Amen. Men,
Women looking for a leader. Amen. They're looking for somebody to pour off into them.
That's it.
Praise God.
That's it.
Amen. Men, we have been.
Come on, tell it.
Y'all, can y'all excuse me real quick? This is because it's people listening to us. This is why I'm saying this. You have, especially in America, you have men that they're so selfish mm-hmm. and self-centered. Mm-hmm. See, that's before salvation, inordinate affections. You know what? Inordinate. Look it up. You know what inordinate affections are? It's when you have a passion for something more than God. When you have a passion for something more than God, what's driving you is inordinate affections. You can love sex more than you love God. Mm-hmm. That's something working in you.
Yeah.
See, that's before salvation, evil concupiscence. See, that's another one too. That's another one. That uncraving desire, craving, all you think about is just driving you. That's why you need the Lord. Yes. And if you got him, if things are perplexing your mind, you're so full of you need to wash.
Yes.
You need to repent. You need to, amen. You need to get on your knees. You need to repent and say, and tell the Lord to forgive you.
Yes.
And he will wash you.
Yes.
He will forgive you. Yes. He will put you on the right path. He will tell you to keep moving on. See, I don't take his love for granted.
Yes.
See, don't take his love for granted because he forgives you. You, amen, and you able to move on. When we gonna get to a place where we're moving in God?
Yes.
When we gonna get to a place where God is using us? Praise God. When we gonna get to a place where we're doing exploits? When we gonna get to a place when he's manifesting his life through us?
Yes.
See, that's what God is. He's trying to get us to. He's trying to get the church. We got to get past being lukewarm.
Yeah.
Amen. We got to get past being lukewarm. We got to get some fire on inside of us. We got to allow him to work through us. Praise God. We got to get past what the anointing of God, amen, is working in our life. Praise God. What people are being set free. Because at the end of the day, he's coming back with his reward.
Yes.
Amen. He come with a reward, but he's going to reward those that do his will, his Father's will. We cannot get comfortable. Saints, let's don't get comfortable. I just want to encourage, don't get comfortable. So, amen, if children walk out on you, family walk out on you, people don't want to follow you, it don't matter. What does it matter? What does it matter? What's greater? What's greater? What is greater? You love father, mother, your own life, sister? Are they influenced more powerful than the love of Christ in your life? Is the influence of the world more powerful than God?
Yes.
It don't make no sense. That's out of order. What do we want? The question is, what do the church want?
Yes.
See, our hearts has been so conditioned.
Yeah.
The world, amen, has crept in the church. And religion don't do it no better. It don't do nothing but create a bunch of pride and divisions and strife and amen and all kind of schisms. And people still walking in
darkness,
the flesh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Still, see, that's what a dead work is. See, you can, amen. A dead work is when God ain't working with you.
Yeah.
You saying stuff. Oh, yeah, you quoting the scripture. But ain't nothing, it's just hollow. Ain't no life in it. We got to get to the source, the one that can give life. We got
yes.
to stay connected to the true vine.
Yes.
Amen. He said, I'm the vine, and you are the branches.
Yes.
We don't want to get to a point where we wither. Huh? He constantly prunes us and He prunes at us. He deals with our minds. He loves us all day long. He gives us things. He allows us to, he gives us wealth. He blesses us on our job. He blesses us with a marriage. He gives us a raise. He gives us beautiful children. But he's still asking the question, when can I use you? I purchased your body. I've purchased you, amen. When I'm going to be able to use the body that I purchased, praise God? When can I use that? We all so caught up in our minds want to do what we feel to do, and we think that's what God's going to accept. God ain't accepting nothing but Christ.
Nothing but Christ.
And let me tell you, let me show you a Blues Clue how Christ is, what he is. He's a suffering servant, one, and he's selfless love.
Yes.
Amen. He's all about, amen, giving to giving. Amen, giving. I want to encourage you, amen, your marriages. Men, step up to the plate. Amen. Amen. Why, man? Yeah, we can sleep with them, all that. What is that? When we can't minister to them. What is that? We pay bills and all that, but sometimes women need a word. Sometimes women need a word of, see, and don't jump into something that when you ain't prepared. Amen. Praise God. Men. Women is looking for somebody that's gonna be able to pour, not somebody to sleep with. Don't get that twisted. That's what's wrong with the whole world today. Men are so self-centered, amen, and cannot pour into
the wives,
the children. We supposed to be leaders. Jesus. You know what a man is? And I used to share this with my son-in-law. I got two of them. You know what a man is? He really ain't nothing but a servant. That's all he is. That's all he is. So, man, let's step up to the plate. Just step up to the plate. Praise God. Be there for them women. I burn for our society and marriage today. I burn for. See, I got married young. I'll be 30 years this year. 30 years this year in marriage. 30 years. And guess what? And it just got good.
Yeah.
Amen. It's just getting good.
Since all the kids are gone.
Amen. Well.
No, I'm just playing.
I love them too.
Yeah.
Amen. Gave my life to them. Still giving my life. Yes. Amen. Because that's what it's all about. When we die. What you gonna tell God when you die? You went to church.
Right.
Oh, you was a good worker. You paid the bills. And God saying, what is that?
Right.
You paid the bills. You was good. What is good? That's the question. What is good? What do God want?
Right.
Praise God. So let's work together. I'm gonna tell you this. This is killer, and Brother Mesa. This one thing, you may not hear this in a lot of pulpits, but that I'm going to be the one, and ain't none of y'all in here got to like me, because I got people that love me. So I'm just telling you now, if you leave, that's okay. I'm still, Brother Herb, going to pray for you, but I'm going to share with what I know. When I see, look out in the world, brother, I see dysfunctional families, I see little kids, looking for a father, looking for the dad, looking for a mother, mother looking for. It's because the pulpit is so perverted because they more concerned about their reputation, money, and they full of adultery, fornication, and all this type of stuff. They won't touch on stuff like this. But we got somebody got to say something.
Yes.
I ain't living this life for nothing.
Yes.
Amen. Just as Jesus did, kept himself sanctified. God give us a will. That's one thing he ain't going to take from us now. He gives you a choice. Because in your choice is only how you're going to prove your love. He going to keep that choice right there. He going to keep you right there with your choice. Because he watching it. Okay, let me see what they're going to do right here. Let me see if I throw this in front of them. What are they going to do? What kind of response they going to make? See, choice, choice, choice. But see, you got to make your mind up. For God I'ma live,
God, I die.
And God, I die. You got to be like Esther. I'm going to see the king. No matter what. If I perish, I perish. I'm going to see the king. It don't matter what. Amen. What? How they do me? I'm going. I'm going to see the king. You chop my head up. It don't matter. I love people. I'm going to see the king. That's what she said. That's what Esther said. She had to get up out of there because she had a burden for God's people. Okay, let's get this thing bare. Okay, all right. Well, no. Okay. This you're right.
So, do we understand how we are baptized into Christ?
Okay.
We have been baptized into Christ. We're not talking about water baptism. We're talking about spirit.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's. I'm in Romans chapter. Brooks, can you help me out, please? I'm in Romans chapter 6. And I believe we stopped at verse 6 and 6. Yeah, we did. Romans 6 and 6. Come on.
Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin.
Okay, we don't serve sin no more. Come on.
For he that is dead is freed from sin.
Come on.
Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him.
Come on. Now, I want to say this. He ain't talking about in the future. He's talking about living with him right now.
Yes.
He, in you. In him, we live, we move, we have our being. That's it. Amen. So he living in us right now. That's what he's talking about. Also, we live with him knowing that. Come on.
Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more.
Okay.
Death had no more dominion.
So he's trying to show us we ain't constantly got to go through a cycle where we dying out. You know, they got all these theories, you know.
You dying daily.
You know, we got us, you know, sanctification is a process. That's a dual nature. Mm. That's what you're preaching, dual nature. Okay.
Say it right.
Let's keep moving.
For in that he died unto sin once.
Once. He died unto sin once. Once. Come on.
But in that he liveth unto God.
Okay, living unto God.
Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
I love it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
He said.
Oh, you want to look at their
likewise reckon.
Mm-hmm.
Do we know what reckon means?
Okay. Consider.
Consider.
Mm-hmm.
Consider that you're dead.
That's right.
Just like he died once.
Just like he died once. Come on, Pri. Keep going.
Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lust thereof.
Mm-hmm.
Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness. Okay,
so you was, right. Okay, that's what you was doing. You was doing that before. You was yielding your members unto unrighteousness, unto sin. Okay.
But yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God.
Come on.
For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace.
Oh, now, Brooks, is that pretty plain?
It's plain. I want to say, though, that it's telling us right here we're left with the choice.
Absolutely.
That's good.
You don't yield yourselves as members, as instruments of unrighteousness. That's up to you. What do you want?
That's it.
So now, as the body of Christ, that's our opportunity to choose God. Who we yield our members to. God is able to keep us if we're led by the Spirit, if we yield our members as instruments of righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
But we make that choice. Who do we prefer? It's all led by our preference.
Yes.
So that's why he's directed, don't yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin. But as people who are alive from the dead, now walking in your identity, yield yourselves as instruments of righteousness because you can, because it's now by the power of my grace and my spirit that you can now.
Yes.
That's the difference. Now you can before you couldn't.
Mm-hmm. Right. Before that was something driving you. Amen. We had something drive.
I just want to piggyback on that.
Go ahead. Y'all piggybacking a lot. Go ahead.
Because why can we now choose God? He was saying it in verse 6. When he said, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, we have to understand that the body of sin and death was placed on the cross with Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And that wasn't some sins that you had. That was the whole old man was put on the cross with Jesus Christ. that the body, the whole reason that Jesus died is so that the body of sin may be destroyed.
That was
the only way we could have liberty.
Yes.
Because there's liberty in Jesus Christ.
Nice.
Because of the body of sin was destroyed with him. It says that henceforth we should not serve sin. That whole workmanship of God, what he did on the cross, is the reason why we are able now to not serve sin.
Yes.
And that's why he says, for he that is dead.
Yes.
When you proclaim your salvation, you're coming to God, you have to first believe that he is Lord.
Yes, he is.
You have to first believe that he is able to wash you, to cleanse you, because you know that he is the only way.
Yes.
So knowing those things, he frees you from that bondage. So I just wanted to point that, because Brooks was going in, so I had to go.
Amen. 14, it really, like it says, and this is really, this right here annihilates all the doctrines that are process and all these things right here. It says, verse 14.
For sin shall not have dominion over you.
Come on.
For ye are not under the law, but under grace.
Amen. Let's jump back to second. We'll be finishing right here.
Can I just say something in James 1?
Yeah,
so
you're okay.
Sin no longer has dominion over us.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever people talk about sin, we have to understand where is that coming from now?
Oh, you want to go to James?
Now,
I know where you're going.
I'm there. So now they sin.
Okay, well, let's go there
since
then.
We're not in bondage now.
Come on.
Since we're free.
Right. Let's show how it's created.
When people do sin and they fall, they blame the flesh.
Yeah. Yes.
But what happened? It's their desires that they're tempted when they're drawn away by their own desires and enticed. So allow it. When desire has conceived, when your desire has conceived, it gave birth to sin, and sin, when it's fully grown, brings forth death. So,
I'm so glad you're going there, man. I'm so glad.
Where it comes from.
But the thing
now,
about it, I want us to keep going, because when he says, "Don't err, my brethren,"
be deceived.
Amen. Don't keep reading.
Do not be deceived, my brethren.
Because it's coming from, like he said, it's coming from your desire now. See, this is the thing. Amen. You can pick back up. You can go. You can pick that thing back up.
You pick your will back up.
You pick that back up and get straight entangled again. Yeah.
Let me say this.
But I want to say this. Piggyback. I want to say this. Now, see the thing. I want to encourage us now. Don't leave sin alone now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because thing about it, he gonna pay you.
Yeah.
You play with it. It come with a payment.
Yeah.
So leave. In your salvation, leave sin alone. Mm-hmm. Avoid the very appearance of evil. Amen. So, go ahead.
I just heard an apostle say this, and this really blessed me.
I'm sorry.
Because we know that we have choice. She said, but she lives every day like she has no choice but to obey. Because the deceiving part is you use your will. And you say, oh, I do have a choice. I can sin. Because you do. But if you see life as for God I live, for God I die, you'll remove the part to sin out the way.
Yes.
So she said we have to live our life like there's no choice but to obey.
Hey.
So many times people just, like Paul said he's a prisoner to Christ.
Yes.
He lived a life like I don't have a choice but to obey.
Yes.
Jesus lived a life.
Yes.
I don't have a choice but to obey.
Not my will.
But if you say, you know what, I do, I can use, and you allow the enemy to deceive you with that thing.
But it goes back to what Brooks was saying, it's that a desire that's enticement. Amen. That's what it is. When something is just like with Eve. No sin, but then here come a whisper. You see him? So what's the choice? So what is our preference?
And all Satan did was just give her a suggestion.
Talking about being dead, that desire usually comes from identity.
Yes.
Seeking something, giving me something, puffing me up, giving me an identity.
Mm.
And so I'm desiring something because I'm looking for something too.
Right.
But when you're dead, when you need nothing, you can't tempt me.
Yeah.
You can't. I don't have a desire.
That's good, right?
Because
there.
I know who I am in Christ, and I have given all things. See, because every good gift and every perfect gift came from above, and I've been given everything pertaining to life and godliness. I know who I am, so you can't tempt me with something different.
And that's what Jesus on the mountain. He knew who he was, so Satan couldn't come and tempt him.
He couldn't do.
He said, "It is written of me.
It's no
it
want.
Is written. It no, no one. All he wanted no was to please the Father. That's it. And if you don't have that mindset, then it'll be easy for sin to just keep staying around you, and you try to fulfill that thing. I love See that you. Because when you don't have a want, sin is nowhere in the picture. You're not even thinking about that. And even when it does try to creep, because Satan is the author. That's what he does. He tries to come and tempt us. That's his job. And if when he does come, all you have to say is no. But because we feel like we have that choice, God didn't make robots. He made us so that we can surrender ourselves to him. Because guess what? There's a token going to be given to us. We're going to be rewarded for our obedience. Yes. For our surrender. There's a token. There's a token that's going to be given to us. And why not now give over a life so that you can get eternal life? Amen.
You want to keep going? That was good. We probably can get dismissed after that. That was so good, because I love, and it's amazing how people can just park. But you keep reading, he says, like you're reading in James 1. Do not err. Don't get it twisted, because every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights. Everything good comes from God, who has no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Then it amen. And of his what did he say that?
Of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth.
The word we was begotten. This is what he's saying.
First fruit of him.
His first fruit. First choice. And you look at that first fruits, you go back to the Old Testament, you'll see how, I believe it was three, don't quote me on it, but it was, I think like the first 3 months where they were some of y'all know about the first fruits. But God looks at us as being the first fruits. Mm-hmm. You see, everything in the old shadows the new.
Yes.
Amen. And that's why I love it, because it's all pointing to Christ.
Amen. Whenever you live as a first fruit, as a son, you can't be tempted by sin, because my man Dan, he said that I don't wake up trying not to sin because I'm too busy loving God. Yes. I'm too busy in the love of God that I'm not sin conscious now. I'm not trying not to sin, because I'm wrapped up in who I am in God. Yes. I'm a first fruit. Yes. My focus is there. So I don't know. I'm not concerned with sin. What church has become, we're preaching this sin consciousness that enables sons to try not to sin, inevitably thinking about sin.
Yeah.
Amen.
And then falling because I'm trying not to sin. And then producing more guilt and shame and condemnation. Instead of just preaching the love of God and being free in Christ.
That's it.
Please, please. Ministers, please, please, please.
Preach the word.
Preach the word and stop talking about all your failures. And you got pastors that get up.
What I used to do,
you know, it was kind of hard before I came to salvation. It was hard. It was a struggle. What are we preaching? Let me hear the victory. Amen. Let me hear the victory, victory, victory. Have you won a battle? Amen. Are you holy? I mean, amen. Are you a new creature, a new creation? Amen. Amen. Praise God. I'm a winner. Somebody say, I'm a winner in Christ.
I'm a winner in Christ.
Amen. The Bible said, I am more than a conqueror through Christ. More than a conqueror. Praise God. All this, like you said, we make people so sin conscious. Because we got this weak, watered-down gospel. Amen. Let's go ahead and finish in Colossians. I'm done, y'all. Colossians chapter 2. Let's go back to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians 2, I believe we 11. Let's go to Colossians 2 and 11. Can I get somebody to read that? Colossians 2.
In whom also ye are circumcised.
Okay, in Christ also, that's in whom, okay.
To 10, and ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power.
I was trying to get you to go up. That's all right. Yeah, I was trying to
get you to dwell with all the fullness of the Godhead. Is that where you're going?
No, I was going to 11 and on up, but he took this.
11 and up.
Yeah, I was going to 11 up. Yeah, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands. If you go back to the Old Testament, I believe that every child on the eighth day was circumcised. Amen. Circumcised meaning a removal, mm-hmm. a removal of something dead or something that's unclean.
Yes, sir.
Something unclean. Remember, we was uncircumcised. We was dead in sin. Okay. In whom also ye are circumcised with a circumcision made without hands in the putting off of the body of sins of the flesh by the what?
Circumcision of Christ.
So Christ is a circumcision.
That's right.
I ain't never heard that. He cuts it away.
Cleanse it.
He cleanses us. Okay, verse 10.
And ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power.
That's it, man. I want to read this. The circumcision of Christ refers to the cutting away of the nature and power of the old man, a sanctifying and cleansing of the flesh. It is an operation of God wherein he removes the dominion of sin from our bodies. He removed that old man. That spirit of iniquity had to go when he came in. The Bible said your temples are the temples of the Holy Ghost, your flesh. Okay? When we are born again, our soul and spirit are placed in the Holy Ghost, and our mortal bodies are quickened and brought alive again unto God. This is in Romans 8 and 11. Our flesh is now the body of Christ, and no longer a body of sin. Sin no longer has dominion over us, and we are free to live a holy blameless life.
Before God.
Blameless. That's a strange word today. Blameless. People will argue you down. You ain't nobody perfect. And I'm always asking the question, what is perfect, brother or sister? So we shouldn't argue with things that most time people saying that they don't even study themselves. Yeah. But they hear. This is what you hear in mainstream.
Or they see other people's failures.
Amen. Or other people's failures.
Because God is not a failure.
He don't fail. There's no failure in Christ.
He's the standard.
Praise God. So I hope.
We love y'all.
I hope we, hey man, anybody got something to add? And
you good?
I know Brother Meech just want to say something.
Nah, this was a blessing, man. Y'all covered a lot. A lot. And, you know, the one thing that I was looking at was, especially when you got into Galatians chapter 5, that Jesus said that the wheat and tares are going to grow together. And that way people can actually see the difference between the flesh, this is people who's living by the spirit. And you will be able to observe that in the body. And you will be able to pinpoint, okay, I can tell this person is angry all the time. They always got, oh man, there's always just something going on with them. And this person right here, they may be having the same issues going on in their life, but you never see it because they're living in the spirit. They're not letting those issues influence their decision making. They're not letting those issues hang on to them. You know, like, oh man, well, you know, I got this bill due. I got that. Oh man, it's like we all got bills due. We all going through things, you know. That's life. When life starts life, and how are you going to react to it? And when that person is living by the Spirit, they realize, I'm only a pilgrim here anyway. none of these things, like, you know, I got nice things, but these things are not holding me back from serving God. I'm not, oh, man, I got to keep this. I got to keep my reputation. I got to keep my image up. Oh, man, I love my wife too, Herb. I love my wife. I wouldn't marry her if I ain't love her. I love my cheering. Even my new one that's coming. Still trying to figure out a name. I love my cheering. But I'm not going to let that hold me back from serving God. I can't. Because before I met my wife, I knew who God was in my life. And, oh, my God, the things you was touching on, man, I experienced all of that. And I truly thank God for being free to make that decision, say, I'm just going to serve God. There's no other choice. I've done so much dirt in my past, and like, and to see God freeing me from that stuff, you know, I wasn't a game bag. I wasn't in the world like that. But it was certain things that had a hold on me. I mean, had a hold, and I mean, it was a stronghold. And I never thought that I would be free from it, but thank God. When I say I never thought I would be free from it, I didn't see myself living without this. But I thank God for the freedom that I have in God. There's true liberty in Christ. And I love how Brooks even brought out how the church, they preach sin so much that it make you sin conscious that, oh, my God, you inevitably end up thinking about sin, trying to get away from sin, thinking that you're going to sin. And you end up sinning. and knowing the mystery of God, how God has made us truly free, that we can serve him and not have to worry about sin, because this is our nature now. My nature is to serve God. Who wakes up thinking about breathing? Do you got to think about breathing? When your eyes open, do you got to think about sin? These are things, you don't have to think about smelling. It happens. It's your nature. And that holiness, that's your nature now. That's why you don't have to vacillate back and forth. Man, am I serving God? Am I living right? Am I holy? Am I in God? Am I out of God today? Man, I woke up, man. You don't have to think about those things because you are in God. You are in God. And like I said, this has been a blessing for me, man.
Okay, cool. Sarah, bruh. You always be coming through. I ain't gonna lie to you. Bruh, it's the grace being set in eternity. That aspect, yes. That aspect is so amazing. And going back to Brother Story, too, as far as what you was dealing with, like, and that grace is a display of that. And the crazy part is that grace, you being free, was already set in eternity. Yeah. And I think for all of us, all of our testimonies, everything that we go through has already been set in eternity past. So it's just like, it's just amazing to me to be able to see that and how the works of the enemy were destroyed whenever Christ came. But all of it was already set before. And I think that was just so good to bring out because, like, you really got to focus on that grace, because if you focus on that, then you don't have to worry about sinning. You don't. Yeah.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Stand up on your feet. I want. Go ahead. Okay. It's stand up on our feet. I want us to, first of all, I want to say that this upcoming Thursday, there's a women's retreat that we're having in Faith Over Feelings, praise God. And I just want those women that's going to be there to kind of come up to the front. God put this on my heart. Amen. I want Sister Kelly, I want y'all come up. And I want you, the men, I want us just to be praying, all of us to pray. Y'all come up behind them. Amen. I want us to just be praying for this move, because I want to say this. Let's just wash our hearts. Let's just allow God to sanctify our hearts in him. And what am I saying? Am I saying that we're sinning? No, I'm not saying that. A lot of times you'll see, you know, God say things even in the Old Testament, how he'll say, circumcise your heart. Circumcise your heart, meaning your mind. Amen. And so, amen, God is just telling us to just, let's just allow God to wash our hearts, and especially for these young women that's going to be laboring out there, because we're going there, and I know God's put this on you guys that have been praying, and you have been communicating, and I know we're looking for a move of God. We cannot allow the enemy to trick us, because he's going to fight. Whenever you step out on, amen, you say you want to do something for God, your enemy, your opposer is right there. And I want us just to be praying for each other, because we're looking for people to be touched. We're looking for souls, people's lives to be changed. We're not worried. This church stuff, let's get this. Let's know that your body is the body of Christ. You are a representative of God in the earth. Literally, and we have to, amen, you got to embrace that, because if we're going to be effective ministers, we got to know, reckon ourselves again to be dead and alive unto God in order for God to use us. There's a lot of people coming all over are coming, and they're looking for God. And so we want to be sober-minded. We want our minds to be sober. Me, for an example, tomorrow I'm social media for 3 days. I'm just getting off of it, because I really want God to begin to just pour and manifest himself. Not us. We got to get out of the way. We're looking for God to do something. We're looking for people's lives to be changed. People are coming with all kind of baggages, all kind of things, amen, in their life. They're yoked up with so many things. Some people, you're going to see devils cast out. So let's get our minds, praise the Lord, let's get our minds, amen. I want us just to be praying in our hearts for one another as we go, amen, out and, amen, and looking for this move. Praise God. God, we thank you, Father. Father God, we magnify your holy name, God. God, we ask you, God, just to be, God, with these young ladies. Move, God. Help them, oh Lord God, to be sober, God, in this hour, Father. Remind them, God, that they are your representation, Lord. Father, we're looking for a move. God, we're looking for a move, God. Use us, oh God. God, let us not battle with a carnal mind. Father, wash us from any kind of carnality that's in our spirit, God. Strengthen our minds, oh God. Help us, God, to submit and yield to your spirit, oh God. Father, we need you, Lord. There are so many people, God, that are longing for you, Lord. God, you chose us. You chose us, God. You chose us before the foundations of the world, God. Help us, oh God. Father, we need you, God. We need you, God. Hallelujah, God. Strengthen her, Lord, right now in the name of Jesus, God. Fill her, God, with your word, God. She's precious. Fill her, God, with your word, God. God, touch your servant, God. Fill her, God. Continue to deal with her, God. Hallelujah, God. Deal with her, God. Touch her, God. Hallelujah, Father, God. Use her, God, in these last and evil days, oh Lord. Raise her, God. In the name of Jesus, God, loose, God. Loose, God, in the name of Jesus, God. God, loose her, God. Loose her, God. Loose her, God. Hallelujah, God, your servant. Loose her, God. In the name of Jesus. 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 Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus, God. Touch her right now in the name of Jesus, God. Loose her right now, God. Loose the anointing, God. Loose her, God, right now. Free her right now, God. Loose her, God, to do your will. Your will, God. Your will, oh God. Use her, Lord, God.
oh God, as your instrument, God. As your instrument, oh Lord God. As your instrument, Lord God. Reach out to him. He loves you. Let him use you. Bring people to the cross. Bring people to the cross. Bring people to the cross, oh God. Use them. Give a boldness. Boldness, 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 boldness. Hallelujah, God. Your servant right now. Boldness in the name of Jesus, God. You know the burden, God. You know the burden, Father God. You know the burden, God. In a life, God. Loose her, God, right now. Freedom, 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 God. Strengthen your servant right now. Strengthen her right now. Hallelujah, Father God. Strengthen her, Lord God. Strengthen her. Give her the wisdom, God, she needs, oh God. Strengthen her, God. Hallelujah, Father. Strengthen your servant, God.
God, we worship you, God.